The Irish Republican Army, the IRA, started with £80 sent from America over 100 years ago. This is America today. American supporters of the provisional IRA marched to the grave of Joe McGarrity in Philadelphia, the man who sent money and guns to the IRA in 1916 for the Easter Rising in Dublin. American money has always nourished the IRA. In the past 5 years, hundreds of thousands of pounds have crossed the Atlantic to support the provisional IRA's fighting men and their dependents. The men at the graveside are following in the footsteps of Joe McGarrity.
We will now have a moment of silence.
There are 20 million Irish Americans, most with little understanding of the complexities of Northern Ireland. The men here have no time for the SDLP, the Social Democratic and Labour Party, whom most Catholics in the North supported in last week's convention elections. Their ancestors fled to America to escape the famine, the black and tans, and the Civil War. They see the conflict as one between Britain and Ireland, not Catholics and Protestants. An IRA veteran, John Joe McGill, delivers the graveside oration.
And I ask you here today to continue to support NORAID and the people who are following in Joe McGarrity's footsteps. Give them all the encouragement. I don't think they need encouragement. They know the cause they're serving. And I ask you as sincere Irish men and Irish women to make sure that that help will come to Ireland, because there can be no turning back this time.
And America has always provided guns for the IRA. These 70 Armalites, a high-velocity sniper's rifle, were seized in America last year. They'd been bought in Baltimore, part of a consignment of 160. The rest had already been smuggled to Ireland. A dozen Armalites recently found in Northern Ireland have been traced back directly to this consignment in Baltimore. Four Irishmen are now each serving 6 years in jail for smuggling these guns, which, as the federal agent demonstrates, come apart and are easily concealed.
Does it break down?
Yes, it breaks down for cleaning purposes. It would break down further if you took the one screw out of here.
So you can break it down, and if you want, you can carry it around in a suitcase or even a shopping bag?
Right.
How would I go about buying one of those if I were an American and lived, say, here in Baltimore?
A citizen of the state of Maryland, for instance, with proper identification, a Maryland driver's license, could walk into any firearms dealer in the Baltimore area, select the weapon of his choice, be it this weapon or some other type, present the proper identification, fill out a government form, and pay his money and walk out of the shop with it.
So if I were a resident here in Baltimore and I wanted one of those AR-15s, all I would have to do is walk into a gun shop, produce my driver's license, sign a piece of paper saying I was a good solid citizen, and I could walk out of the shop carrying that with me.
That's absolutely right.
And it really is as simple as that?
It's that simple.
Fundraising in America is coordinated by an organization called NORAID. The money supports Republican prisoners and their families in the north and south of Ireland. This dance raised £2,000 for NORAID. It also raised morale. It was John Joe McGill's farewell party on the eve of his return to Ireland after 6 weeks of fundraising. The music is appropriate. John Joe was released from Loncash earlier this year.
It's my pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, to make this presentation to John Joe McGill, in appreciation for your dedication and sacrifice to the Republic movement, from your friends in New York, April 18, 1975. It is my honor to be one of those.
IRA bombs and bullets have killed hundreds of British soldiers and policemen, and civilians too. But the IRA counts only its dead.
I would like to point out
that over 150 soldiers, men and women of the Irish Republican Army, has laid down their lives for freedom during the last 5 years. They were not selfish, they were not self-seekers. They are men dedicated and honourable. The men of this age are going to win, and England must get out. England must get out of her country, lock, stock and barrel. And if she wants peace, she's better not play cat and mouse with the IRA, because a bomb could again bust in their faces. Goramila Akarjan.
Their national chairman is now Brendan McCusker.
If your money goes to support the dependents of prisoners in the north, presumably that helps keep up the morale of the prisoners, the morale of the fighting men. And therefore, couldn't you say that the money from America helps fuel the war in Northern Ireland?
You could say that we provide, by the way, the people that are fighting for freedom, those that are deprived their freedom, those that have consistently striven for their freedom, the necessary support morally and financially to gain that freedom, and that you can be assured, and the people at home I know are positively assured, that we will continue to support the struggle for Irish freedom.
So the money does help the fight continue?
The money sustains those, by the way, that would, by the way, believe and would never give up the fight for freedom.
Do you support the provisional IRA?
I support the provisional IRA. I support their policy, the provisional IRA policy, which is the ultimate liberation of Ireland, the 32 county concept under a federal Ireland, the policy of Éire Nua. Yes, I support that concept, and I do believe it is the only solution to the Irish problem.
And therefore, you support their use of violence to achieve that end?
I support the use of violence to achieve that end, yes, because I do believe that that nothing has ever been gained, by the way, any war, that there hasn't been violence used in it.
Can you honestly say that not a penny of money raised in America has been used to purchase arms for the provisionals?
I can honestly say that, yes.
How can you be so sure?
Well, as much as you're asking me, I can be that certain.
Northern Aid have to file their accounts with the Justice Department in Washington. These show that to date they've sent over £500,000 to Northern Ireland. This letter indicates that between August 1971, when internment started, and January 1972, which ended with Bloody Sunday, Northern Aid paid £40,000 in cash to Joe Cahill.
Is any money sent to Ireland in cash?
Cash, no. No money is sent to Ireland in cash. It's sent by check through the banks, yeah.
But there was a time when it was sent in cash, wasn't there?
Not to my knowledge, Peter, no. I'm speaking from the time that I've been involved, yeah.
Which is since when?
Since 1969.
Because the Justice Department records, which you've submitted, show that about £40,000 was actually given to Joe Cahill in cash in 1971-72.
Justice Department records. Well, as I'm telling you, I'm speaking as national chairman, and I've been national chairman for the past year. I wouldn't be privy to such things that happened in the past if that was the case. I'm just taking it in the frame of reference that you intended it to me. I certainly wasn't aware, by the way, that did happen.
Can you categorically say that none of the £40,000 in cash that was given to Joe Cahill was used to buy arms for the provisional IRA?
I would say categorically yes, because I know the type of man that Joe Cahill was. I know he has been a long-standing Republican, and I know the innuendo that would be attached to that.
Joe Cahill was a leading provisional, and at that particular time, the provisionals had a desperate need for guns and a desperate need for money. All I'm suggesting is that, is it not likely that some of that £40,000 from here may have been used to provide the guns that the provisionals then desperately needed?
Well, I would take issue with your suggestion. You know, I would just happen to disagree that it would be, you know.
So you don't think any of that money was used for guns?
None at all.
Brendan McCusker is also liaison officer of a new and important organisation, the Irish National Caucus. The men who run it all support the provisional IRA.
The state of California, which I just arrived back from after an extremely successful and an overwhelmingly positive response.
This is one of their meetings in Philadelphia. The Irish National Caucus is an umbrella organization for most Irish groups in America. In city after city, the caucus is enlisting recruits to make sure that politicians support the cause of Irish unity in next year's presidential elections. Fred Burns O'Brien is the caucus's information director. His grandfather ran Guns to Ireland 50 years ago.
We've got the electoral process in 1976 coming up in this country, and we've got all this working for us, the bicentennial, the fact that America drove out Britain 200 years ago and the principles are the same, and whether some Americans like to admit it, the tactics used by the Irish now were copied directly from the Americans, the so-called terrorist tactics, the sniper. The American hung out of the trees where the IRA man would be in a rooftop. You know, it's basically the same thing.
In practical terms, what does the Irish National Caucus hope to achieve as a pressure group?
Just last year in 1974, there was $65 million worth of weapons given to the United Kingdom. Well, the Irish National Caucus, through the hearings in Congress, we're going to get that, hopefully, get that military aid stopped until such a time that Britain would pull out of Ireland or give a declaration of intent to pull out of Ireland. And we can do it on the theoretical basis. We did it in Turkey. Turkey, also a NATO ally. And the fact that we were able to cut off aid to Turkey, by the way, through the intercession of the Greeks, who aren't quite as large as the Irish, they put the pressure on and the United States stopped it. And we feel that we can do the same thing. We see the American system and how it can be used, how a pressure group like the Jews, they're our prime example. Here's a 3% of the American population, and look what they've done. They've got this country. If Israel, you know, breathes funny, the Americans respond. Well, we're going to do the same thing. We got 10 or 12% of the population here, and perhaps even more. I know we've got at least 10%, and we can put pressure on, and we are in political positions of power, and we can use that, and it's all within the law. Over 100 members of the Congress are of Irish descent. That's 25%. That's more than our number justifies, and we can use that.
How do you regard the provisional IRA?
And I believe that the IRA were forced to take up arms. I think they tried, or they would have been willing to try politically, but there was no avenue open to them politically. And they had to resort to arms, and we support the aims of the provisional movement over there because it is the only group seeking United Ireland.
Do you support the provisional IRA?
I do, yes, and I'm on record for quite a long time now for supporting the provisional IRA. Not because I like violence. In fact, I think violence is one of the most ugly things in the world. But I'm more concerned about the fundamental violence, the root causes of violence. You see, I see the IRA violence as symptomatic. And my belief is that if the British cancer is removed from my country, the Irish symptoms will disappear. And I further believe, and I don't think this is just a theory, it's everybody, I'm sure, believes this, that for as long as the British remain in Ireland, there will always be patriotic young Irish men and women who will resist. Now, that's a fact.
Over the next few months, what impact is America going to have on Ireland?
Considerable. On Britain, on the British government, is where our impact is going to be. Next year, 1976, is the most propitious date. It's the bicentennial of the American Revolution, and it'll be so easy to remind Americans what their revolution was about, against whom they fought, the British government, and to state simply, all the Irish people, all the Irish nation demands is the basic rights that you people fought for. The same objective that George Washington fought for. It's also an election year, and with the organization that we have at the moment, even at present, but particularly as the months go on, we will be capable of not simply saying to a congressman, please show some concern for oppression in Ireland. We will say, congressman, if you do not get involved, then in each area of your constituency, we are going to actively do our damnedest to beat you in the election. The days of pleading with congressmen, those days are over.
In Washington, the lobbying has already started. Next month, Congress is planning hearings on Northern Ireland. The Irish National Caucus hope to provide key witnesses. The chairman will be a New York congressman, Lester Wolfe. Over half his constituents are Irish. He once visited Loncash in disguise.
Are you aware that the Irish National Caucus is a front for the provisional IRA?
No, I am not aware of that at all. When you say it's a front, that's a pretty strong charge.
The people who lead and run the Irish National Caucus are sympathizers with the provisional IRA.
You're then saying that the Ancient Order of Hibernians, which has been a group that has been in existence in the United States for perhaps almost a century, are a front group for the IRA.
I'm saying the Irish National Caucus is, not the Ancient Order of Hibernians.
Well, the Ancient Order of Hibernians is part of the Irish National Caucus.
If you were aware of that, would that be something that you would be concerned about?
Oh, yes, very definitely. I'm not going to be used by any front groups or any back groups. And I have been given to understand that the Irish National Caucus that exists here is an amalgam of people of Irish ancestry who are interested in solving the problems generally of the Irish.
But you didn't know that they supported and sympathized with the provisional IRA?
I believe that they support various positions of various people in Ireland, and particularly the people of Ireland. I have no knowledge whatsoever that they support any group in Ireland.
Like the Provisional IRA?
Like the Provisional IRA.
Teddy Gleeson doesn't know a lot about Northern Ireland. The caucus persuaded him to become their secretary.
How important a body is the caucus, do you think?
Well, I think it's grown in strength. I think it's grown in strength. I think in respect also, I think the people now are beginning to recognize that they're a moderate form in bringing everybody together, because you have all the Irish groups now, whatever their programs are, funnel them through the Irish National Caucus.
Are you aware that the Irish National Caucus supports the provisional IRA?
No, I'm not mixed into that thing. I don't know the first thing about it. I wouldn't know the difference between the provisions or the regular. What I'm interested in here now is the trying to get unification of Ireland, stop the fighting.
All I'm saying is that you are an official of a body that supports the provisional IRA, and that is something perhaps that you ought to be aware of.
I really think that somebody has to support somebody over there. Otherwise, you're not going to get any place here, because there's killing on both sides. There's militants on both sides over there. And somebody has to protect the other people.
Do you support the provisionals?
No, I have never given that the consideration. I have never, that has never come to into my mind, and I never had any discussions with the Irish National Caucus over it.
And docks are a good place to smuggle guns from. It's impossible to search every ship, scrutinize every container. Guns have been found in Dublin, hidden in containers from North America. The Armalite rifles now in Baltimore were seized on their way to the docks. The politician whose law firm defended the Baltimore gunrunners is a hero to the men inside Loncash, Paul O'Dwyer. 30 years ago, he ran guns to the Jews to drive the British out of Palestine. Paul O'Dwyer is one of New York's leading politicians, president of the New York City Council, and now a director of the Irish National Caucus.
But would you accept that some of the money raised in America does go to the provisionals?
Oh, yes, I would think so. I would think so.
Which may be used to purchase guns?
I wouldn't have any doubt about that.
Would it be quite easy to get hold of guns in America and then ship them to Ireland?
There is no problem, unfortunately, with getting guns in America.
And how would I get them across to Ireland?
There never has been any great problem with respect to that from 1919 up to the present time. The arms went from here for the war against the Black and Tans in much greater number. I think America supplied practically all the armament for the Irish Republican Army against the Black and Tans at that period of time. So in a shipping area like New York, Philadelphia, Baltimore, New Orleans or from the Canadian ports, Boston. Shipping goes out, in and out all the time. And if we were able to watch that closely with respect to any contraband, we would be able to stop the narcotics problem in America if we had that kind of surveillance.
Do you support the provisionals?
I don't condemn them. I consider the provisionals as a logical outcome of oppression. And the provisionals are no different from the American revolutionaries that we're going to celebrate 200 years ago.
In the 1940s, you were involved in gun running to the Jews to drive the British out of Palestine.
It's been a kind of a myth that has grown up somewhat, and I haven't taken the trouble to deny it, and I'm not going to now.
Are you engaged in gun running to Ireland?
No.
In no way?
In no way. I don't, if you think in terms of my failure to condemn the provisionals as giving encouragement, well, so be it.
Why do you think it is that Irish Americans support the provisionals, whereas Irish Catholics in the North support the SDLP?
I think that's an improper statement. I was there. The ghetto supports the SDLP and the provisionals, both. One for one reason and one for another. And that's traditional in all movements of this kind.
The SDLP get the votes.
They get the votes, and that's in the election, because they would not probably trust the revolutionary, as it were, with the government. But by the same token, when they're in trouble and they're in difficulty in their ghetto and they're being bombed out, or the British soldiers are coming in to smash their furniture or to take their people out in the middle of the night on a one-sided adventure, then it is, they realize in the North, and I've talked to them too, these two things are not inconsistent. It isn't either one or the other. They support both. No provisional could last unless he had the support of the people.
And no provisional could last indefinitely without support from America. At the graveside ceremony in Philadelphia, Fred Burns O'Brien and his fellow pilgrims, Father Sean McManus and Brendan McCusker, dedicate themselves to the provisional's new and perhaps most devastating attack from America, the political offensive. They know the ceasefire has given the provisionals a breathing space and that the fighting men are being released from Lankesh. They know that the chances of the convention producing a peaceful political solution are slender. They know that the ceasefire is shaky, and they know, above all, that if the provisionals take up arms again, Irish Americans will be ready to foot the bill.